It's very, very sensual, everything. Visually, orally, you know, sights, sound. The tempo, the rhythm of this town is something very alien to me. The other artists and myself, it's almost as though we're from another planet, and that is a fantastic thing to experience. I'd been out on the river and watching the gold prospectors on their big rafts called dragars, and they have these huge floats that can be up to, I don't know, 60 to 100 feet long. They were just very beautiful, so I decided I would like to see if I could get hold of some of these. They're just tubes of steel, and at the bow end of them, they have this very simple point. The way they made the point and constructed this very simple cone, as though it was made out of paper or cardboard or something, specifically to do with the way things are made in this area, you know, a minimum amount of fuss and the minimum amount of labor to put into something. It's crude, but it's efficient. I really enjoyed this shape, which was sort of half animal and then half landscape. I mean, it seemed to flip between the two things. And it was on that sort of edge between the landscape and this sort of animal, dolphin-like shape, that I built the rest of the sculpture. The other points sort of turned into mountains. I mean, very similar to Rio. The guys who work every day in the workshop have been fantastic. I've been working specifically with one guy called Antonio, who's done all the welding and cutting for me, and another one called Eduardo, who has a very beautiful lathe on the other side of the workshop. My feeling is, I might be wrong, but my feeling is that they've been they've had an opportunity to show skills that they have when they were working on the railroad here, and they've been using them in a way that they don't normally do.
Die sind ja auch wieder. Wahnsinnig gut hier. Ja, sieht schön aus. Von Cucumaxo. Von Teco Calepedel, was ja nicht schwer.
Also wie ich 2 Zentner bestimmt. Ziemlich schwer, du. Zu schwer. Oh, sehr schöne Form. Weißt du, wo mich die teilweise auch daran erinnern? An diese Meeresgeschichten, weißt du? Seesterne und diese. Pass auf! Geh du da weg. Also da siehst du, dass es wirklich organische Dinge sind, dass sie direkt aus der Natur kommen. Wirklich aus der Natur übernommen sind, ja? Hier siehst du das perfekt. Und auch wieder das totale recycelte Material, ja, aus diesen Blechen, diesen dicken Blechen geschnitten, ja? Ja, das Gelbe, ja? Ach, die Form ist aber schön. Guck dir mal die Form an hier. Ja, das ist wie Ananas, weißt du? Das ist wie Ananas. Auch die Farbe, das Gelbe. Guck mal, die Hörner hier.
Es kommt sicher daher, dass das Boot repräsentativ ist für das ganze Ambiente hier, für das Amazonasgebiet, für die Flüsse, für die Menschen, die hier leben, angefangen bei den Indios bis hin zu den Caboclos, zu den Leuten, die an den Flussufern leben. Das Boot hat eine ewige Form, das ist niemals verbessert worden in seiner Grundform, in seiner extrem den natürlichen Bedingungen angepassten Form. Seit tausenden von Jahren existiert es und es gibt keine bessere Form, um damit auf dem Fluss zu reisen, zu fahren, von einem Ort zum anderen zu kommen. Es ist der Fluss, dem Fluss selbst angepasst, kommt aus der Natur, kommt vom Fisch, vom Blatt her und trifft jetzt auf diese extreme europäische Art von Skulptur. Ich fasse also beides als Skulptur auf, sowohl das Boot als auch diesen Elektromast. Und dieser ist deshalb so extrem europäisch, nicht nur, weil er dort erstmals benutzt wurde, um Strom, Nachrichten etc. zu übertragen, sondern auch, weil er eine ganz bestimmte Form hatte. Er hat nämlich eine Kreuzform, das jetzt den Kopf nach unten hier aufgehängt ist. Und versuche diese beiden Skulpturen einem skulpturalen Konzept miteinander zu verbinden. Und dazu benutze ich Energie in Form von Licht.
Eu gosto de siri. tem siri do casco mole. No Pará tem siri do casco duro.
Na Bahia tem siri do casco mole. No Pará tem siri do casco duro.
Eu já comi pedra de siri, é tão gostoso. Ai, como eu gosto quando saio por aí. O caranguejo também é delicioso, mas eu não como porque eu gosto é de siri.
I'm afraid you can't go in there.
Why not?
Because this piece, it's supposed to be closed. You're not supposed to see what's inside, only through the cracks. Come over here, I'll show you that. I mean, either here or here, I think you have good visibility. The maximum the public can see, try it here. It's through a crack like this. Well, this is not finished, but when it's finished, of course, it will be much narrower.
Why is that? Why can't the public go inside?
Because it's the whole idea of the piece, you see. It's a piece about peeping. It's like a peep show. You have to discover, bit by bit, what's happening inside.
And what is happening inside?
Oh, I won't tell you. I mean, you have to discover yourself. You have to peep. There are some things inside, or the absence of certain things, and that's entirely up to you. I mean, you have to be patient enough to peep.
In Belém, you know, we was all sitting in this huge Hilton hotel. We all wished to go somewhere to wild. So when we finally got the news that we would take this boat trip, we was very happy. I'm on this boat, sitting here and just looking Amazon. It's going very slowly and my mind is relaxing and I take the boat as my body. I have a title of one work is call boat emptying, stream entering. I take the boat like my body, like on the wild sea, on the wild river. If you have too much ballast, too much luggage, too much in your mind, then you must throw everything, you know, over the board. And only then the boat can bring you to safety. So to me, you know, this trip is like cleaning my mind. You know, when you go through the jungle, everything looks green and there's nothing there. It's like almost dull because it's dense green and trees and you can't see through. It was wonderful, the trip with one of these ecologists. He stopped and talked 3 hours about all kinds of things. And then you really start seeing the layers of life from the bottom to the top. It's hundreds of things going on there and you are not aware at all. One of the wonderful stories he told us that the very young leaves in jungle turn, actually, they look like dry old leaves to protect themselves from the insects. And only when they actually grow, they become beautiful, large, green, bright leaves.
Like in Europe, there will be, when the leaves are red, there will be autumn.
Oh, no.
Or they are dying.
Now I hear the leaves that are, they're yellow and the red leaves are the new ones.
So you mean by generation they protect themselves, genetically they develop this way?
Well, the protection, I'm talking about are chemicals. See, we can't eat any of these leaves because they're all protected with poisons, with distasteful chemicals.
That's why
it's so unusual to find any plant here in the Amazon whose leaves can actually be consumed by people. There's no lettuce, no natural lettuce, no natural cabbage.
There's only actually insects and the birds who are eating.
Right, but because of the pressure on the plants, they're all very well chemically developed. They're protected. And a lot of these same chemicals are the ones that can actually be used as pharmaceuticals, as insecticides.
The whole
forest is a chemical factory.
But for me, this was just the beginning. That was really far away of being over, because since a long time I'm interested in minerals, because I believe that minerals really have certain energy. And I need to go to the mines. I need to go much deeper to the real jungle where the real stones are. And I was very lucky to meet almost immediately on the beginning of our trip a small man with bright eyes and kind of strong body, very vital, who, I don't know his name, maybe I think he told he was called Rui or something like that. But we all decide to call him Bukowski from now on. Bukowski had his plan on his own. Whatever we said to him, he didn't want to change his mind. He really saw my almost fever for the minerals. The moment I saw the quartz on the ground, my eyes brightened and I started talking to him. And then he opened somehow his heart and he said, you know, if you come that far here, that means that quartz, crystal calls you.
This is the kind of energy we completely forgot. For example, Aborigines in Central Australia, they take little pieces of quartz and put directly in their head. And we put our quartz in the watch. And then they, Aborigine once told me, you know, we put our quartz in the head, you put in the watch. We know what time it is and we know what time it is. So this is how different cultures work with the same material. And this energy material is completely forgotten in our culture. So I try really to somehow rediscover again and build objects with this material. It's a kind of the square of energy or pyramid of energy. And I like to sit or lie just facing this quartz wall and put myself in a state of mind of emptying myself in order to communicate with the crystals, and I like they tell me what to do. I just not trying to have any idea before I concentrate on them.
In this exhibition I'm now doing with other artists, I decide to take 6 large quartz stones and put them just on the floor, and they almost look like a kind of futuristic bombs with the points going upwards. And next to these stones, I will take from just simple favela around Rio, these little chairs, you know, with the 3 legs, 4 legs, just the chairs who the people used to sit in the poorer villages, the ones who makes you sitting on that kind of chair very close to the ground. You're really small. You are small and the stone is huge in front of you. And I will call this crystal cinema. Only thing what you have to do is to look the crystal, and he tells you the past, future and present. This, all the political issues about ecology and everything is not really what I would say my cup of tea, but I'm absolutely as an artist concerned about nature, and I was very aware what means you know, preserving the nature. Here, you know, everything is in the process of destruction. I mean, this is a fact. But in my work, what I like to do is to use the crystals who are here in Amazon and somehow give the awareness about them and try to make people seeing these crystals, seeing the potential in energy, and in order to somehow respect more planet, because planet is living being.
Urubajara, na beira do mar, fumava cigarro de palha, sempre ao luar.
Urubajara, na beira do mar, fumava cigarro de palha, sempre ao luar.
Urubajara logo percebeu que caminhando a lua também se moveu. E foi então que correu e no alto mar se atirou. Mas Jussara ouviu.
Não, uma chapa linda.
Mas eu quero
várias.
E-a-ué, e-a-ué.
Lua minha, lua bonita, lua índio não pode perder.
E-a-ué, e-a-ué.
Lua minha, lua bonita, lua índio não pode perder. A lua é minha, a lua é minha. Esta lua caminha comigo, esta lua é minha.
A lua é minha, essa lua caminha comigo, essa lua é minha.
So, as a teacher, a fish usually swim in groups of the pitanias, and I just created the idea of waves, some higher, some shorter.
Urubajara. Na beira do mar, fumava cigarro de palha, sempre ao luar.
Urubajara, na beira do mar, fumava cigarro de palha, sempre ao luar.
Urubajara logo percebeu que caminhando a lua também se moveu.
E foi então que correu e no alto mar se atirou. Mas Jussara ouviu, Urubajara gritou. Madre infelice, corro a salvar.
Das Ganzkörperkondom.
Ich denke, es gibt ein paar sehr philosophische Krankheiten. Eine davon ist AIDS. Ist auch eine interessante Geschichte für Kontakt, für Nichtkontakt. Ein Zeichen. Das ist ein bisschen, würde ich sagen, zwischen Spaß und Ernst. Die Benutzung dieser Industrieformen dafür, diese Kraft der Explosion, die da drin ist oder so, das ist für mich.
Aber was hat das mit dem Amazonas zu tun? Das ist synthetischer Kautschuk. Ne?
Die Idee für dieses Material kommt grundsätzlich von hier. Das heißt also, als die Europäer vor 500 Jahren hier angekommen sind, sind sie also das erste Mal auf dieses Material gestoßen. Und von hier aus ist es nach Europa gekommen. Und mit der Erfindung des synthetischen Kautschuks ist die Sache dann mit dem Naturkautschuk bis zum gewissen Grad natürlich beendet gewesen. Ne? Und all diese Sachen sind insofern ein Folgeprodukt. Bist du aus der Puste? So, da haben wir den Fünften.
The chainsaw as a tool to symbolize the many forces that have destroyed the environment. Maybe certain societies being maybe more powerful than others and trying to use their power to erode, you know, the cultures of other societies. So this area that you see represent the areas of the world that are still left untouched. The areas that are to be destroyed have been destroyed already. Yeah. So what are left? The significant symbols are the ones that are left. And over here, we have another one, which is also a symbol from my country, Ghana. And it's entitled The Life Which is unexamined is not worth living.
Also ich denke, wir haben es hier mit einem Teil des Zinswunders zu tun. So jedenfalls der Titel der Arbeit. Und das ist also der Entwurf für ein Möbel für zwei beteiligte Personen? Ich denke, es ist immer ein Spiel. Jedes Spiel von Macht oder Bürokratie ist etwas für zwei Seiten, ob mit oder gegeneinander. Und die Thematik der Zinsen hat mich in der Vorbereitung auf diese Arbeit sehr intensiv beschäftigt, weil ich denke, der Weg der Übertragung von Wertvorstellungen von internationalen Geldsituationen, das ist einer der Hauptpunkte für diese ECO 92.
About whether it was going to start. Yeah, but I'm happy now.
So where does it go now?
Well, we'll keep it inside there. Yeah.
And then? Afterwards?
Until when it's ready for real.
And after that, are you taking it home with you?
Eventually. Yeah. Okay.
Meine Arbeit befasst sich immer mit der Sprache der Dinge. Die Dinge sprechen sich selbst. Dann der zweite Punkt ist eben immer, jeder Gegenstand besitzt eine Seele. Und hier in Porto Velho habe ich mich eben, wie gesagt, befasst mit den Goldsuchern, die auf großen Schiffen leben und an diesen eben so Saugrohre sind, die besondere Köpfe haben. Und diese Köpfe nennt man hier Ananas. Ist, weil ich, wie gesagt, immer mit Fundstücken arbeite, das Prinzip des Recycling. Und sie sind mannigfach selbstständig. Sie zeigen unheimlich viele Spuren der Fertigung und Formen groß und klein. Das setzen wir einer gleich da hinten ran, dann können Sie das immer weiter runtersetzen. Ja, dann können wir sehen, dass wir das da hinten hinkriegen. Und dann kommt das automatisch nach unten. Das sieht man ja. Und dann müssen wir eben ein paar Dinge austauschen,
ja,
weißt du?
Ja, das kommt schon in die nächste. Können wir gleich hier außen hinstellen.
Das war also für mich sehr wichtig, diese Sachen auszusuchen. Ich habe sie ausgelegt wie so eine Art Plantage, Ananasplantage, die auch in Reihen läuft. Köpfe zeigen eine unheimliche Brutalität. Umso stärker man in die Tiefe, in den Boden gehen muss, umso größer, umso kompakter sind sie. Und diese Köpfe habe ich jetzt sehr lieb gewonnen. Die haben wir jetzt nach hier von Porto Velho hierher gebracht, an den Riffe, an den Fluss. Und ich hoffe, dass sie aussagekräftig genug sind, das, was ich meine, auszudrücken. Thank you.
Vous travaillez ici? Le travail que je suis en train de préparer, j'avais commencé à l'imaginer en France. Je voulais faire quelque chose où je n'emprunterais rien de l'Amazone, juste comme des images. C'est pour ça que j'ai voulu faire, quand j'ai su que le lieu où on allait travailler était ce grand atelier en tôle, j'ai voulu garder une empreinte de l'idée d'un atelier en tôle, et sans même prendre les tôles, en laissant tout ici, juste en utilisant des choses comme du plâtre, de la peinture. Je ne l'ai pas ici, mais j'ai voulu aussi amener une autre idée, qui est un peu une idée de l'Europe ou de l'Amérique parfois, de donner des leçons. Et j'ai amené du papier peint qui représente la forêt vierge, mais de façon idéale, pour mettre dans son salon, un peu idyllique. Et ce papier peint est fabriqué dans ma région, dans une ville à 20 km de chez moi. C'est pour ça que je l'ai acheté, c'est pour ça que ça m'intéressait. D'être un peu ironique sur tout ce qui se passe à propos de l'Amazonie, parce que moi j'ai pas de jugement à donner, j'ai pas de leçon à donner, mais juste même parfois dire, la situation est un peu triste entre ici et nous, et la forme que je veux donner à mon travail, je voudrais faire un peu comme des châteaux forts, un peu l'image de ce que nous sommes, c'est-à-dire fortifiés, donneurs de leçons comme ça. Là. Oui. On travaille comme des fous ici depuis qu'on est là. Et on est vraiment dans une tension incroyable. On a vraiment la main dans la prise de courant. On est complètement électrifié par tout ce qui se passe. Tout ce qui se passe dans la rue, tout ce qui se passe dehors, tout ce qui se passe dans la forêt. Même le climat, on est complètement en prise directe. Et ça, je crois que ça se ressent dans le travail. Peut-être dans une force, ou dans une brutalité, ou dans un côté kitsch. C'est un peu tout ce qui se passe. C'est que l'on vit 2 semaines, 3 semaines avec les gens. On travaille avec eux, on parle avec eux, on visite avec eux, c'est même pas des visites, on se déplace au cours de leur travail avec eux. Il est absolument impossible d'être un touriste après. On ne peut plus être un touriste, ça devient insupportable. Avant d'arriver ici, j'avais aucun a priori, c'est-à-dire que je n'avais aucune idée précise. J'ai lu pas mal de livres, j'ai essayé de voir pas mal d'émissions sur l'Amazone, mais ce côté complexe, c'est-à-dire que chacun a sa propre idée. Quand on lit les livres scientifiques sur l'Amazone, on se rend compte que personne n'est d'accord en fait sur la pluie, les arbres qu'on coupe pas, les gens qui meurent parce qu'ils n'arrivent pas à manger, donc on les laisse brûler la forêt, puis finalement la forêt ne repousse pas. Donc toute cette complexité m'intéressait. En étant ici, je me suis rendu compte que c'est encore beaucoup plus compliqué. La solution, il n'y en a pas. Absolument. Pour moi, c'est absolument évident. Il n'y a pas de solution. Il y a plusieurs éléments. Il y a des éléments qui vont disparaître. Soit les gens, soit la forêt, soit... Je ne sais pas, mais il y a des éléments que... Ou nous qui allons disparaître. Et de toute façon, ça ne peut plus rester comme ça. Ça, pour moi, c'est absolument évident. Ça ne restera pas comme ça.
I'm asking people to touch the earth, and hopefully the earth becomes kind of energized in some way through that process. It's just extraordinary when you bring, you know, 20 tons of clay and 40 people together and say, let's try and make an equivalent for ourselves, but in a comfortable size that will fit between the hands, and make them quickly, because I don't want them to be representations. I just want them to be something that is the equivalent for the human body, but fits into the hands rather like your heart fits inside your body. everybody finds their own way of kind of taking the clay, and it's a sort of moment, really, the moment of where it becomes, from being just a lump, something particular. And that moment is confirmed by the making of the eyes, which is a moment of concentration for the maker, but also the moment in which the clay becomes conscious. There have been extraordinary passages in the making of the piece that have reflected, I think, the social conditions in which these wonderful people live. I mean, I think, well, what I've experienced through working with them is, you know, this enormous reservoir of energy and feeling, passion for life, which is in a way unfocused and untapped. And I've come very close to, I think, some experience of what life means for these people in very difficult circumstances, in a city which doesn't really have a reason to be here. What happened to the ones that were that melted in the rain? Did he remake them?
Os estavam molhados, eu levei para lá. Aí eu recompus os outros, fiz o resto.
Tem quanto você falou?
Quanto você fez?
130.
Very good. Tá bom?
Tá.
Obrigado. Ei, Tony.
Aqui.
Okay.
There's a sense, I think, in which if this is clay that has come out of below the visible surface of the earth, then there's also something that's coming out of people. I hope that what this piece is about some kind of marriage between the geological future of the planet and the evolutionary future of humankind. My feeling is that in some way the Amazon is the kind of has become the conscience of the world, insofar as it's the focus for feelings about the ecological future of the world. Asking questions about personal space, about the collective body, about population, and how that is or is not linked to the earth. I think it'll have a very strong sense of human overpopulation in the piece.
Afogada no tempo.
Bem, nós não sabemos até hoje o número exato de das nações indígenas dizimadas. Nossos antepassados foram massacrados, escravizados, mas eles estão aí e continuam resistindo. E nós estamos aqui em busca das nossas raízes culturais.
Está na mesma casa, tem a tua cara, tem a minha cara, tem a tua cara.
É um trabalho que lamenta os mortos, mas que também busca a identidade dos que estão vivos, a nossa identidade. Nika Wikna, em tucano, significa os que estão na mesma casa. É o conceito de família, talvez o mais belo que eu conheça. Nika Wikna, os que estão na mesma casa. E os que estão na mesma casa têm a nossa cara. Tem a minha cara, tem a tua cara. E é com esse sentido de reflexão sobre as nossas raízes, a busca da nossa própria identidade, que nós vamos agora fazer o resgate.
Na mesma casa tem a tua cara, tem a minha cara, tem a tua cara. Tem a minha cara, tem a tua cara, Banzeiro manso, cuia desce, chama acesa, sonda o rio, em busca da vida afogada no tempo, perdida nas águas, pra roda do remanso onde fica o lugar. Tem a tua cara, tem a minha cara, tem a tua cara. Quem está na mesma casa tem a tua cara, tem a minha cara, tem a tua cara.